We need you, God. We surrender our will. We're nothing without you. Hallelujah. We're nothing without you. We need you. Hallelujah. We were born with a Christ. Will you shed your blood, Jesus? Your precious blood. Oh, hallelujah. All of us and all of us.
Somebody said, thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. We're thankful. We're thankful. We're grateful. We honor the Lord. And we honor his presence in this place. Hallelujah. We honor the Lord and we honor his presence in this place. Thank God for Pastor Mosley, and we thank God for all of you here tonight. Let's stand, let's stand, let's stand. Three people, it's good for us to be here. strength of my life. I lift my hands in total prayer to you. Say that one more time. Tell him to.
Known not just in this place, but in this place. The place here, as we hear the word tonight, we want God to make this place ready. Let somebody tell them this place. I'm the place. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure. One more time and we're going to hear the word, no music. Lord, prepare me. Tell him tonight to be a saint. Oh, that sounds so beautiful. Pure and holy. Try. Woo, and with thanks. Oh, yes, I will. Sanctuary, sanctuary. Lord, Lord. Now clap your hands if you really meant what you said. Come on, come on, clap your hands. Clap your hands till... Tell, before you sit down, tell the person next to you, I'm ready. I'm ready, I'm ready, I'm ready. Take your seat if you mean it. I'm ready, I'm ready. We've been in a great time all week. We've been in a great time all week. And I thank God for all of you being here tonight. Listen, this is Sister Peach's idea. Let me put that out there first of all. I didn't put my preachers up. Sister Peaches put them up. Amen. I want that disclaimer out there. Amen. Matter of all of this, Sister Peaches. Amen. So whatever happened tonight, it's on Sister Peaches. Somebody say praise the Lord. In all sincerity, I'm humbled and honored to have these three young men, and I'm going to say it all now so they can come without interruption. All of them are gifted. All of them are anointed. All of them are called by God to teach and to preach. And I'm so thankful that God sent all of them my way. I'm so thankful God sent all of them my way. So we'll start tonight with Elder Ridgley Hudson, who just celebrated his 21st birthday Sunday. A young man who is truly outgoing, and he loves the Lord and he loves the work of the Lord, and it doesn't matter what it is, he's willing to do it. Come behind him would be Minister Jason Daniel, who is the youngest of them, 19 years old. He is Pastor Mosley, what the older saints told me I was. He's truly a young man with an old soul. He truly is that. But he loves the Lord and loves the church of God. And then closing out would be Minister Cordell Grantham, who just celebrated his 21st birthday last Thursday. Multi-gifted. I'm not going to go there with you, Doc. Daddy Mosley said he's older than him, but Daddy Mosley was with the children of Israel when they crossed the Red Sea, so I know that's not true. Glory to God. But Minister Grantham is gifted. He's a chief musician at our church and our youth pastor. And he was the first, what was that, 20 what, when you, no, when you preached your trial, when you, 2020, during the pandemic, he accepted his call to the ministry. So Elder Hudson, Minister Daniel, then Minister Grantham. Let's give them all a big hand.
Let us hurry. Hebrews 11 and 1. I'll be reading from the King James Version, if we all could stand, as that is our custom. And it reads, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." You may be seated. We're talking about faith for the future. But if I was to tag it, I would put an assurance of hope. If I can pose two questions, do you believe that Australia exists? Have you ever been there? I have not seen Australia with my own eyes, but I've seen pictures of it. I have spoken to people from Australia. Many reputable people agree that it is Australia. Based on these evidences, I have no reason to doubt that there is a continent named Australia. We may not see God himself in this life, but there is evidence all around that he exists and that he keeps his promises. This is not to say that we will always understand everything about God, because we can't. And if we did, there would be no reason to have a God. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9 says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and so are my thoughts higher than yours." And so, beloved, today I come to tell you that God is not to be figured out. He's to be followed. And in order for you to follow him, it takes faith. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, it takes faith." Faith is the substance, the hypostasis, the foundation of things hoped for. New Mount Vernon is built on a good foundation. All of us sitting here, these pews are built on a good foundation. It's holding you up. So faith is the foundation of things hoped for. It is the evidence or the eglikos of things not seen. Faith is a basic requirement of life that keeps your hope alive. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, keep hope alive." It is to keep your hope alive and from being shaken when forced with trials. The stronger your hope, the stronger your faith is in God. And so I come to tell us today that our faith is built, it is strengthened in our circumstance, in the things that we face in life. Faith is the most potent force in the whole universe that opens impossible doors. And the master key to a world of good reports. That's according to Hebrews 11 and 2. God desires us to have an intimate relationship with him. For genuine faith anchors our relationship in him. He requires us to believe and trust in him who is more able and competent than we are. God is the God of all creation. You must have faith in him in all situations, circumstance, and in every aspect of our lives. For he is true, he is faithful, and he is our anchor. Faith makes the ordinary extraordinary. It makes certain of your realities you do not see. If you can see it, then it is not faith. We all have this ability to breathe. Breathe in something that we do not see, called oxygen, H2O. You can't see it, but you feel it. You can't see it, but it's in you. And so that's what faith does. It does not overlook your current circumstance, but it allows you to look beyond it. Some of us walk around sick, but we say, "I'm not sick." That's a lie. That's not faith. Faith looks beyond the sickness. See, when we sit, when we walk around saying, "Well, I'm not sick," but you are sick, that's not having faith in God. That's having faith in yourself that I'm just not going to be sick. We'd sit and name it and claim it, haul it and call it, and all this other stuff. That's not faith. So when somebody asks you, "Are you sick?" "Yeah, I'm sick, but I'm getting better. God is a healer." That's proof of faith. So faith not only, it does not overlook my current circumstance, but it allows me to look beyond it. The issue of faith is based on expectation, and that is things of the future. So what is hope? What are you hoping for? Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, what are you hoping for?" Hope simply means an expectation of what is to come. Our hope is in Jesus, for without him, we have no hope. Albert Barnes said, "Hope achieves for the soul the same thing which an anchor does for a ship. An anchor preserves a ship when the waves beat and the winds blow. And as long as the anchor holds, so long the ship is safe. And the mariner apprehends no danger. So is with the soul of Christians. In the tempest and the trials of life, his mind is calm as long as his hope in heaven is firm." Right. And so I come to tell you, beloved, to keep the faith. Yes, keep on pushing. Yes, don't give up. Yes, don't give in. Yes, don't throw it in the towel. but keep the faith. So let's talk about this real quick. Hebrews 11 and 1. It talks about faith. This is known as the faith chapter, which is to warn and encourage the people, which were the Hebrews, facing trials to maintain their faith in God, not to return, listen to this, to their old ways. The preceding chapter, Hebrews 10, talks about God's faithfulness and how important the subject of faith is, even as Christ returns, draws nearer. So Hebrews 10 and 23 says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promise. So I believe this is what led us into this conversation talking about faith. The chapter was written simply to inspire us to grow in our faithfulness to God. The Apostle Paul opened the chapter by defining faith. What is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. He mentioned testimonies of those great men and women who demonstrated their faith in God. He talked about several people down through Abel and Cain. He talked about Enoch. He talked about Noah. He talked about Abraham. He talked about different individuals who had strong faith. We are not meant to limit our focus to all these faith heroes, but use their stories as testimonies to build our own personal faith. Hebrews 12 and 3 says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your mind. It finally admonishes us that even if we do not receive the promises, God has provided something better for us in heaven, which is our eternal home. So, beloved, we must understand that this faith is essential. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, faith is essential. It is the foundation. It is who we are. It is what we do. It's everything about it is important. It is essential. Faith is essential. Faith is necessary. And so faith is a gift from God. No one has faith from the beginning until they begin to move closer to him. The word substance is the delivery of your expectation, which give the believers the grace to withstand trials and temptation. Let me help you. When we all came to Jesus, we came to him just as we was, with nothing. But God took that nothing and made something. And in order for that to happen, it took faith. Say amen, somebody. And so again, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen, which talks about the reality of those things that cannot be discerned with our physical eye. All right. For 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 tells us, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Because, listen, sight can only take me as far as I can see. All right. But when you walk by faith, faith takes you beyond what you can see. If I walk out those doors, I can see 8 miles, but I can't see 7 miles. I can't see 6 miles. So my faith takes me beyond sight. So that's why in 2 Corinthians it tells us, for we walk by faith and not by sight. So if we can see God, then we do not need faith to believe in him. Man says seeing is believing, but in God's kingdom it is the complete opposite. It is believing before seeing. Circumstances sometimes make us doubt God. And if it does not change, we feel that God is not keeping his promises. I'm almost through. We cannot live by faith if we do not have enough knowledge of God's word and power. See, most of us have faith in things. Most of us have faith in the world and faith in our jobs and faith in what the doctors say and faith in what everything else. But we don't have faith in the word. How can you trust a God who you're not seeing, but you can't love somebody that you see every day? That's faith. It takes faith to love. And the Bible says three things abide: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And so how can we tell that you have faith? Not just by what you believe, but what you do with what you believe. If you believe this Bible, if you believe what God said in his word, you must have some kind of faith. The Bible says, by our love shall men know we are Christ's disciples. Because by our love, the Bible tells us that you should love your enemies. That you should pray for those that despitefully use you. It takes faith to do that. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, it takes faith. Because if you cussed me out last week and you talking about say something good to them this week, it takes a whole lot of faith to do that. So the NIV version says confidence. Faith is the confidence in which we have. And then it also mentions assurance. Confidence is the product of the substance of faith as it was mentioned. NIV mentions assurance, which mentions conviction, which means the same. Assurance or conviction is also the product of the evidence of faith. This verse has an important role to play in each of our lives. And I got one more minute. I'm almost through. If you must live a triumphant life on earth, then you must have faith in God to direct you so that your life can have meaning, it can have direction, and it can have purpose. The most suitable time to express our faith is when we are in our darkest times, when you're struggling, when you're going through. When you read the story of the woman with the issue of blood, it took faith to reach down and touch the hem of his garment. Those people had Jesus' attention, but she didn't need his attention to get healed. She believed he had a medicine closet in his coattail. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. When they were out fishing and Jesus said, cast your net on the other side, it wasn't the fact that there was fish on the other side. It was their faith that believed that what Jesus said is true. And so we need to have a fellowship district, faith for the future, faith to move forward, faith to understand, faith to grow, faith to go out and win souls. Jesus didn't say, just go fish and cast your net on the side. He said, I'm going to make you fishers of men. And so as we move forward, keep the faith. As we move forward, demonstrate your faith. And as we move forward, continue to keep your trust in God. Thank you and God bless you.
Oh, bless his holy name. Thank you so much, Elder. You put me in bad shape, Doc. I want to continue on where Elder left off and talk about faith for the future. I want to look at Timothy in the second chapter. Second Timothy, my apologies. The first chapter in the fifth verse. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded it is in you also. Verse 6 says, therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. You may be seated. This text deals with the faith that has moved through Timothy's family lineage, and now it's on him. And the author sees this faith and acknowledges it and encouraged him to carry on and continue in that faith. As I reflect on this message, I look back on my upbringings. I was raised in the church, and my grandmother and aunts and siblings and cousins were there, and we were taught how to pray. We were taught how to love. We were taught how to go to God and ask for what we need. We were taught to believe in a man that cared for us, a man that died for us, and a man that looked down and saw our faults and needs. We should be encouraging our young people to develop this same amount of faith, this same prayer life, this same endurance, this same discipline that we have. It is very important that as the senior generation, you pour into the young people of tomorrow. You pour into the people that God has placed before you. You pour into the seed that God has blessed your ministries with. We should be passing along the message of Jesus and his infinite power and love. We should be passing down the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding that we learn throughout our years in ministry. Your trials, your troubles, your struggles, and your upbringings, your upcomings should be encouragement for the young people. You should use that knowledge and give it to somebody else that is coming behind you so that they know how to walk in the stair that you once walked in and go further in God. And once you show them the way, once you give them the example, once you let them know that there is a God who cares and that there is someone and something for them to do, you then begin to into them ministry goals. And you begin to show them different assignments, different things that they can do within the kingdom of God. Their gifts begin to come out. And as they come out, as the senior generation, we must cultivate and develop our young people. It's a sad thing when you see a church that does not put emphasis on youth. It's a dangerous place when you're in the house of God, but the next church is not being poured into and empowered. How can I carry on where you left off if you don't show me? How can I preach well if you don't talk to me? How can I love right if you don't love me right? If you don't show me how to love, show me the way. Help me to be what God has called me to be. Help me to do the work that God has for me to do. I believe that once the younger generation sees your faith, They see that you love right. They see that you pray right. They see that you are blessed. They see your kindness. There's a zeal there now. Now it's time for you to come in and to pray over them and to lay your hands on them and to anoint them and to keep them at the altar. Keep them away from the hand of the enemy. It is now our job to do everything we can to help push their potential and push where God wants them to go. The future church is not just some rebellious church. They're not just some church that does not care about protocol or order or etiquette. They're a church that wants to learn. They're a church that wants to listen. We are a young people that want to do God's will. But we need you to love us properly. We need you to show us the way properly, how to be. We need you to pass on everything that God has poured into you. So as you go out the door, we can come in ready to tear down the devil's kingdom, ready to build up God's church, ready to go out there and find souls. We will be ready now. We're prepared. You have equipped us. You've prayed over us. You've talked to us. You've disciplined us. You've showed us things. You've set us down and talked to us so that we can understand the way ministry works and the way God works and how to know and develop ourselves through faith. We all have gifts. Our young people have ministries. God has put things inside of them that is vital to this world, that are vital to our churches, that are vital to our communities. So it's time now for us to stop marginalizing the young people. It's time for us to stop tearing them down. It's time for us to stop arguing with them. It's time for us praying to stop praying on them and pray for them, pray with them, walk with them and talk with them so that they can be ready for God. So that they can stand in the position of readiness and usefulness. They can stand in a place where they know now they are confident in the teaching that they received at home. They're confident now in God because grandmama not only prayed to a God, but showed you the God of her faith. I stand today because of grandmother's prayers. Grandmother didn't just pray, she showed me how to pray. When the grades didn't look good, she told me, baby, you got to pray and try. Have faith and then apply it. She taught me that God can stand there for me. She taught me that God would help me through my trials. She taught me that God would love me when even in times I didn't love myself. So push your young church. Push your future. Push the next generation. Raise up the Joshua generation within your churches, within your homes, in your communities. And when they come along, when they don't look the way you want them to look, when they don't sound the way you want them to sound, when they don't do it the way you used to do it, don't turn your back on them. Don't turn away from them. If they're not doing it right, then properly take them under your wing. Gird them and show them the way. Help them to do right. Don't just tear them down, but build them up. Where you see an area of weakness, perfect it. Where you see an area for growth, help them to grow. But it's important that you don't just talk to me about growing and you're not growing. I need to see your growth. I need to see your change. I need to see your conviction. I need to see God's power working and moving in your life. So now there's no excuse. You've shown me the way. I know better, now I gotta do better. I've seen better, now I must be better. I was taught better, now I must live better. We have a young church coming up. There are young people filled with God's spirit and ready to run on. But we cannot run on unless we are properly taught, unless we're educated, unless we are uplifted, unless you build us, work with us, show us, help us, push us up, help us navigate through the waters. Tell me my dress is too short. Tell me my suit ain't right. Tell me I gotta pray more. Tell me I've got to do better because God cares for me, because there's a work for me. Encourage me. Bring me into the sheepfold. So as I leave you today, if I can leave you with a message, we must work together to develop and cultivate not a perfect church, but a growing church. Not an arrogant church, but a correct church. Not a spiteful church, but a loving church. Not an envious church, but a kind church. And as your young people sit in your pews, don't leave them there. Bring them up with you. Show them right. Have them in Bible study. Have classes and programs that are geared towards developing our young people. Show them that you want them here. Let us know that you are embracing us so that we may go on and have a zeal for God and have a want and a desire to fulfill his will for our lives. Show us holiness so we can walk right. Show us love so we can talk right. Show us kindness so we can be right. Show us that it's okay to fall and get up. Show us that there's a God that cares for us. Show us that when we're wrong, we know how to correct ourselves. Show us how to study God's word, how to stay on our face until God moves from heaven. Show us how to prepare media and how to be over finances, how to deacon, how to usher, how to trustee, how to nurse. Train up a child in the way he goes. And if you love him properly, if you put God in him, he won't depart from it. He may stray away, but God will bring him back in. I'm a witness. I was there. Now God has brought me back to the place where I must be, where I should be. So my message to you all, to the younger generation and to the older generation, walk in love, walk in kindness. Show the young generation that God is with them. Work with them to stir up the gifts and develop what God has placed inside of them so that they can reach the people that they must reach, so they can take on the goals that God has set before them, so that they can master the levels in which we need to develop our church. It is important that we take our youth and nurture them and cultivate them and love them and help them and guide them so that they will be ready to stand in your position one day, so that they will be ready to go out and develop ministries of their own, so that they can live kind and just Christian lives, so that they will show a dying world that there is a risen Savior that cares for them and that can change their lives. So as you go back to your local church this Sunday, as you see your young people doing things that you may not like, don't talk about them, don't hate on them, don't tear them down. Pick them up in love. Walk with them. Lead them the right way. Guide them the right way. Be that example that they need to see. Be that light that they need to see, so that they can know that God cares, so that they can know he loves them, so that they can know that there is a better way of doing things, so that they know the church of today wants them around, so that they feel loved. Pour into your young people. Build them. Don't destroy them. And as God continues to bless you and increase you and show you things and give you wisdom, pass that wisdom on so it's not wasted. It's a sad thing to see once thriving churches die because nobody poured into the young people. I thank God that I attend a church that pushes young people to do better, that encourages the youth to want better for themselves, for their communities. So let's all as a district work together to fill this place by pouring into our young people, by developing their minds, by developing their ministries, by developing what God has for them inside of them. Let's birth and stir up the gift of God in our young people. God bless you.
Can y'all just give my brothers a hand? Thank God for them. Oh my goodness. God is so good. I want to keep this train moving right along, and we're obviously still talking about faith for the future, but I want to tag in and just talk about confidence in the Creator. I'm going to come from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 7. I'll read from the New Living Translation for your understanding. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Don't be impressed with your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. You may be seated. Faith is the vehicle that takes you from the point of only trusting in what's tangible to believing that what's really intangible is more powerful anyways. God sometimes feels like he's not right next to us. It feels like he's not inside of us. It feels like we really cannot see him, obviously, because God is a spirit. But the point of what I'm trying to relate to you tonight, and even during this message and what we're trying to say, is that you may be able to see your mother, you may be able to see your father, you may be able to see your pastor, but nobody can keep you from the wiles of the devil like our God can. Somebody say amen. Many reasons, the reason why many of us cannot get on this faith vehicle is because our desired destination is not where God wants us to be. We don't have the same goal in mind as he does for our lives. So ultimately, we fail at getting on the same boat that he's on, getting in the same car that he's in, getting in the same vehicle of transportation that he is in. This is why many of us struggle in life, because we don't understand that when you accept that no matter who, what, when, where, or why, I'm going with God. That's when you make that decision, that's when your alignment will bring blessings from the most faithful one. Let me share three things with you, and then I'm out of your way. Number one, the scripture tells us to trust him with all of our heart. I have a few questions for you, but one of my first questions during this lecture are, where is your heart? Who are you attached to? What's pulling on you? What's leeching itself to you? What is stopping you from giving God 110% of your heart? Why are you struggling with giving your heart to the one who made the heart? I'm not talking about the organ beating in your chest, but I'm talking about your inner spirit, man, your soul, the soul inside of you that God placed there in order to keep you aligned and keep you to know that he is the one who is the author and finisher of your faith. Just as the Bible declares, where is your heart? Where is your heart? Is it in your boo? Is it in your bae? Is it so tied up in chasing a career? What is it tied? Is it tied up in your car? Is it tied up in succession? Is it tied up in getting rich quick? Is it tied up in hustling? What is it tied up into? Because until you give him all of your heart, he cannot fully take you in faith to where he's trying to take you. The second question I have is very similar to the first question, but it comes from a different outlook. My second question is, who has your heart? Because a lot of times, because we're not in the Spirit, because we don't believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, we allow manipulative people to take control of our spirit and our soul. Young people, please hear me tonight. Don't allow anyone, I don't care how good they talk, I don't care how good they look, I don't care how good they smell, I don't care how good they sing, I don't care how good they preach, I don't care how good they play an organ. Don't allow anybody to manipulate you into thinking something and believing something that is not scriptural, that is not aligned with God, that is not in God's will for your life. Don't allow any man, woman, boy, or girl to come into your life and snatch you out of your destiny and cause you to forfeit what is right, cause you to forfeit what should have happened at 25. Now it's got to happen at 33 because somebody besides God had your heart. It's not worth your time. It's not worth your money. It's not worth your energy. Second thing he tells us to do is seek his will in everything. And I'm almost done. Seek his will in everything. Listen to this, y'all. Faith is obedience even when the obligation seems obsolete. The reason why a lot of us can't get into faith alignment is because we think that what God is asking us to do is impossible. We think we're incapable, and we don't believe that God can provide the resources for us to do it. The resources for you to live right are already in the Word of God. The resources for you to live out your calling are already in the Word of God. The resources for you to get up, preach, sing, whatever you are called to do are already in the Word of God. The resources you need are already there. You just need to tap into the power of the Holy Ghost and allow Him to take control and stop trying to do it by yourself. What are you trying to do? Have you prayed? Have you consulted God about your calling? Have you consulted God about the situation you're dealing with? What are you trying to do? Last time I checked, He was omnipotent. Last time I checked, He was omniscient. Last time I checked, He was in control of everything. Figure out what you're looking for and who you should look to for it. If you're looking for the wrong things, you're going to look in the wrong places. My last point, and I'm totally done. Stop depending on what you think you know. I rushed so much to try and get to what I thought was grown, but I realized I'm really not grown. Like the preacher told you, I'm growing. And in rushing, I thought that I knew it. I thought I knew it. I didn't know it. I thought I knew it. So every now and again, I have to bump my head so that the Holy Spirit can remind me, look what you thought you knew. What if you prayed before you went and said that? What if you prayed before you went and bought that? What if you prayed before you went and did that? Many of us are in situations begging God to take us out. I mean, you crying, you shouting. Preachers laying their hands on you. You can't get out and you can't figure out why. I'm here to tell you tonight, the reason why is because you did it and you didn't pray about it. I've been there. You didn't pray about it. Why didn't you pray about it? Because you was like, I don't got the faith to even pray about this. I don't have the faith to even ask God for this. Why would I ask God for this? Why? You know it's silly. You know it's silly, yet you went and did it anyway. You didn't have the faith for it to make it happen, but ultimately you had, and I'm talking to myself, you had the stupidity, Cordell. I'm talking to myself. Ignore me. You had the stupidity to do it anyway. The greatest wisdom and knowledge you can ever receive will come from the Holy Spirit. The greatest. No one is smarter than Him. No one is bigger than Him. No one has more control than Him. No one can give Him what He will give you. The greatest thing in life is wisdom. That's why I chose Proverbs, because Solomon was talking to the young people. If you look at chapters 1-9, he's specifically talking to young people, and he prayed. He didn't ask God for a car. He didn't ask God for money. He didn't ask God for a house. He asked Him for wisdom. Now tonight your assignment is, what's my next thing I'm going to ask for?
Dr. Flanagan, I'm laughing because he dropped the mic. Oh, Lord, let the church say amen. Weren't these young men phenomenal tonight, I tell you. Now, Daddy Moses, y'all can't tell me nothing tonight. Them boys was something else today. Now, I'm going to be scared straight tomorrow night, but you can't tell me nothing tonight. Give Sister Peaches a hand. This was her idea. She did a good job. I give you credit, Sister Peaches. You did a good job. You did a good job. You did a good job. Boy, oh boy. That thing tickled me. Woo. But I want you to know something. What has been said, that's my preacher that's grown and pastoring and got his own thing going now. But I just say this. The most beautiful thing is Mr. Daniel talked about planting those seeds into the next generation. And I want you to know something. One of the most rewarding things is for God to let you live long enough to see the seed you've planted grow. And I promise you, if you plant the right seed, they'll grow. They'll grow. Now, I've been blessed with a lot of preachers, various ages, but these three, I'm harder on than anybody. I'm harder on them than anybody. Matter of fact, I'm going to tell them a few things in the midst of this transition. I'm going to take them right out that door and tell them a few things. But guess what? When somebody knows you love them, you won't have a problem correcting them. Peaches and I have a relationship. So when I say something to Peaches, and sometimes I'm tough on Peaches too, but Peaches knows I love her, and she knows she loves me. And love makes the difference. Most of us are trying to change a generation that we've never showed affection to. I didn't drop the mic. Is the mic on? There's no proper correction without proper investment. Love. And when you love, when you plant the right seeds, God will let you watch those seeds grow. I thank God for all of you here tonight. And we're going up. I like Daddy Moses. We're not going down, we're going up. This is our youth and young adult night, and according to the National Baptist Convention, this is my last time, Pastor Mosley, in the youth and young adult night. They say you're 18 to 35. Yeah. Y'all, I've got to go with Dr. Flanagan. I've got to go with him next year. But, Doc, I want you to know you're not too far behind me. You're going to be out in just a little bit. But I want to thank Director Riley for all she does and all of her team. Would you give them a hand? Give them a big hand. Give them a big hand. Few things I want you to do as we prepare to transition. Don't forget to go on your Facebook page, Fellowship District. Find that page, like, tag, and share that page. I'm on it, Pastor Mosley. Like, share, and tag that page. Do it right now. Pull out your phone. You go on your phone in church anyway. So don't act like you don't go on your phone while you're in church. You do that anyway. Go on your Facebook, go on your page, find that Fellowship District page, like, tag, share that page. If you take a picture, if you make a comment, put that hashtag on there, TFG2023. Say that, TFG2023. All right, make sure you're doing that right now. Listen. Now, I have to be a moderator right along through here. I need your registration. Uh-oh, got quiet. I need your registration. Say amen. Some of you are getting benefits, but you haven't given any money. You got your flyers on the table. You've gotten scholarships. But you haven't given anything. Oh, yeah, I got to be a moderator along the way. This is where folk, this is where you got to have faith, brothers, because where you have to say this tough stuff, that's where faith come in. Listen now. I said like this. If I invite myself to your house, the least I should do is bring something. And if I say I'm a part of something, the least I should do is do something. Yeah, because I say I'm a part, right? When I say I'm a part of something, that means I should do something, right? Right. Go ahead, Reverend Brian Valentine. You know he come out Burnette Baptist Church. But I'm just saying, make sure, brothers and sisters, that you're in order, because the work that goes on, ministry costs money. Amen. If you go to the show, you're not going in until you pay. If you go to a restaurant, you're not leaving until you pay. Why do we do less when it comes to church and the work of the church? If we can have that much respect in the secular world, we ought to have that much respect for God. Amen? Clap your hands and say, yes, Lord. All right. Don't forget, tonight's the night. I see Minister Ray over here. I see him. He's all coordinated at everything. I see him, and I want you to know we got our eyes on you tonight. So behave, all right? All right, very good. Dr. Clay, you come on. Minister Valentine, Reverend Brian Valentine, y'all come on. You brothers go down, go back down. Huh? You going to the car? Oh, no. No, you dropped the mic. You definitely can't be scared now and go to the car. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Dr. Clay, come on. Minister Valentine, come on. Reverend Suggs, come on. Minister Ray, come on. Let's get ready to go. I don't have my book with me, but let's get ready. Those of you that are on the side, please. That's what it was. I'm with you. Those of you that are on the side, please come to the center aisles. Please come to the center aisles. Let's fill it up in the center before we go ahead, preacher. Sit right there. Sug, sit right here. Valentine, there you go. Y'all got it. All right. Lord, I got your big bag and everything. You're something else. All right. I'm going to sit right on that front. I've got my eye on you now. You behave. Yes, sir. All right. Those of you on the side, please come to the center. Please come to the center. Little Freddy, Nurse Freddy, and got on the front. Go ahead. Yeah. Ha, ha. Yeah. Y'all come on in the center. Let's fill up these centers before we move out. So glad to see so many of you tonight. Dr. Clay, obedience is better than sacrifice. Do what I asked you to do. Thank you. Not your own. Somebody been knowing you as long as I've been knowing him. They just ought to do this. Amen. Say amen, church. Amen. My God. Come on, y'all, in the center if you can. Let's fill up the center. Some of you have on your yellow. Y'all look so good. Truth of the matter is, I really didn't think I should have had to wear yellow because I'm already yellow. Yeah, the knee slapper, huh? You are too, Kayla. Be quiet. What you talking about? These boys getting out of hand, I tell you. You got it. Oh, don't worry. Hey, Cynthia. God bless you. All right. So glad to have my Third vice moderator, Dr. White, you got to get on the front. He's been working, but he's here tonight. Give him a big hand. All right. Yeah. All right. I want to ask Sister Connolly. I want to make sure they're making ready. Y'all making ready? Amen. We're going to get started. And we're going to have a good time. We're going up. So I'm going to ask the worship team to just start making their way this way. Go ahead. Y'all even got Baby K up in the front. Lord Jesus. She don't sit in the front at Greater Burnette. She up in the front today. Praise the Lord. They're my people. I can mess with them. Amen. I love them. I love them. Even Freddie, I love him, I tell you. Yeah. He's ready, yeah. If I need a nurse, he's ready. He can take his mother's place today. Look at here. Look at these little ones, all right? We're looking forward to a high time tonight. Please don't forget your registration. Please. Where's our women's president? She did a beautiful job last night, didn't she? Bless you. Bless you. She did a beautiful job. Beautiful job. And you ladies were here in grand style. Who is that, Suzette? All right, get where you're supposed to be, Suzette. Bless your heart. Got any brought any of that soap you make? Amen. Oh, yeah, I know she did. My Christian education sister said, amen. Amen. God bless you. All right. The worship team is ready as we prepare tonight to go higher. I don't know what we're going to do with Mother Holloway. She walks fast with that cane. I think she needs to put it down sometime. She walks fast with it. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. We come to bless the name of our Savior. Yes. If you don't mind, let's rest on our feet. Let's stand all over this building. Hallelujah. If you're able to, please, we're going to worship and praise God together. Hallelujah. Yes, it's important that we worship him together and we reverence him for who he is. He is our Savior. He is our Lord and he is our master. We can't always reverence the president when we don't reverence our Savior. When the president walks in, we stand. So when Jesus is in the room, what you gonna do? Hallelujah. What is your response to our Savior? Come on, open up your mouth and give God praise. Has he done anything for anybody in this building? Hallelujah. Let the glory of the Lord, let it rise among us. Oh Lord, let it rise. Hallelujah. It's a familiar song, so if you know it, join in. If you don't know it, listen a little bit and join in. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Sing, oh, let it rise. Yeah. Sing, oh, let it rise. Come on, clap your hands like this.
voice for Jesus in this place. Come on, we can do better than that. Come on, lift your voices and worship the King of Kings in this place. Come on, give him glory, give him honor, and give him praise. We want the glory of the Lord to reign, to rest, rule, and abide in this place. We want his glory to consume anything that's not like him in the name of Jesus. So lift your hands right where you are and receive his presence now. Receive his glory now. Receive his love now. Receive his deliverance now in the name of Jesus. If you love him, just clap your hands right here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord, everybody, everybody. Praise the Lord. Come on. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. God is good, and he is greatly to be praised. I am excited about tonight. I know that I am in a church, and I am with a group of people that love God and that praise God. I know that we're going to give God some rambunctious, unorthodox, crazy praise on tonight. Where is your expectation, church? Has God done anything for you today? Praise God, praise God. Amen. Before we move along in the program, I want to establish protocol on tonight. We have to honor our pastors and our leaders. We give honor to Pastor Mosley as the shepherd of this house and the president of this, the Fellowship Congress, Pastor Johnson. Amen. The moderator of the Congress. Amen. Amen. We give God praise for Sister Allen, the woman's president. We give God praise for you. And all of our district leaders, state leaders, national convention leaders, we give praise and we give you glory. We give praise for Sister Riley, amen, who does such a phenomenal job with the youth and young adults, amen. And lastly, we give praise and honor for any pastors that are in the house. If you are a pastor, just simply wave your hand, stand on your feet so we can acknowledge you at this time. Amen. We give God praise for you. Amen. So moving right along, we are going to have a scripture reading by Junior Deacon Corey Thurman, and then a prayer by Sister Latoya Jones, and then we'll have someone come and lead us in our evening hymn, What a Fellowship. Let's give them praise as they come.
Good evening. Scripture for the night is our theme scripture. It comes from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 and verse 6. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I just want to say that you got to have faith in God. And to build that faith, you got to read this.
Amen, amen, amen. Let's praise God this evening. We got to praise God this evening, for he is worthy to be praised. Father God, we lift our name, your name to you, Lord God, as we are gathered today in this sanctuary to praise you, Lord God, for the marvelous things that you have already done. And I heard somebody say, Jesus, if you don't do nothing else, that you've already done enough. But Father God, I call upon your name tonight. Father God, carrying our leadership to you, Lord God, that you will continue to breathe a new, fresh anointing on them, Lord God. That they begin to build more ministries, Lord God, to save souls, Lord God. For the newborn to come running, Lord God. For the senior saint to come running, Lord God, saying that it's time to change. Father God, I ask, Lord God, that you watch down, Lord God, over the young men, Lord God, that is in the world, Lord. Father God, where the world has counted them out, Let them know that the world don't know what God has in store. That is power in the name of Jesus. So Father God, I declare now, Lord God, I declare right now, Lord God, that he who the Son sets free is indeed free indeed. Hallelujah, Lord God. So continue to touch down on our moderator, Lord God. Father God, continue to allow him to have a vision, Lord God. Father God, I ask that you continue to watch down upon Sister Peaches, Lord. She has a heart for the people, Lord. Father God, I ask that you continue to show her the way. And Father God, an even greater calling. Help us, Lord God, that call ourselves saved. Teach us how to follow, Lord God. Help us to be humble, Lord God. Help us to be submissive, Lord God, so that someone would see Jesus in us and come running, what must I do to be saved? Lord God, I know that you are listening to our prayers when we call upon your name. Father God, I know that you are listening when folks are crying. Father God, I know that you are listening, Father God, right now in the name of Jesus. So Father God, continue to shower down on this service. Father God, healing will come from this service. Hallelujah, God, power will come from this service. Right now, we all declare it in the name of Jesus, and let every saint in the house say, in Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let's do our evening hymn. What a fellowship. Come on, clap those hands. If Jesus walked in the room, how would you sing? What a fellowship! What a joy divine! Leaning! What a blessing! What a peace divine! Leaning! We are leaning! Christ my faith! We are leading. Christ my faith.
We serve a God. coincidence that it was all of the young people that had the tambourine. But I believe that they had that tambourine to show the world that they know the God that they serve, saying you know, even at a young age. They got the tambourine to show the world that we are not like the world, but we serve a God that called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. They are setting the stage. Second time at a fellowship gathering, so I think I'm doing good. I want to be invited back for something else. So I'm going to do what I'm going to ask to do. My God, I know this is for a good time. That is the most sanctified version of what a fellowship I've ever heard in my entire life. The most sanctified version. I knew I was in the right place on tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. We're going to have the Mind Ministry of my brother, Brother Gavin Jackson, who's a member of Peace and Goodwill Baptist Church. Amen. And followed by his Mind Ministry, we're going to be gifted with the music ministry of Sister Jasmine Cribbs. Let's give God praise as they come.
Overcome, no, I can All you gotta say is this. Say, I decree it. And I declare it. I shall win. Everybody help us.
I decree it. Declare.
I shall win. No, no, no.
I shall win.
I decree it.
I decree it.
And I declare.
Some more stuff, but if I had time, I would just look at you and touch you, tell you, touch your neighbor to your right or to your left, and tell them, say, neighbor, you're looking at victory. Just tell them, wish I had time. Just look at one person and tell them, say, you're looking at a victorious believer. You're sitting next to a miracle in the making. You're sitting close to an individual that recognizes and realizes that no weapon that is formed against them is going to prosper. That every tongue that rises up against them in judgment is going to be condemned. You're looking at somebody who realizes that greater is he that is within me than he that's within the world. You're looking at somebody that realizes that they're the head and not the tail, that they're above all the and not beneath.
Let's give God praise for the Mind Ministry of Brother Gavin Jackson. The song said, I win. Sometimes you got to declare, even in a dark place, in a hard place, that you are an overcomer and that you shall win. I think one of the ministers who all three of them so eloquently spoke and preached under the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost, he said, having faith is not ignoring your sickness, but he said, having faith is saying, I'm sick now, but I know I'm going to be healed. That's what he said. He said, I'm sick now, but I'm going to be healed. So when you can declare that you're winning in a low place, I'm broke now, but God's going to deliver me to a rich and wealthy place. I'm sick in my body now, but I believe Jehovah Rapha, the God who shall heal of thee. I may have lost my way, but I serve a God who is going to help me navigate and find my way. We got to speak those things that not be as though they were. Speak to your mountain. That's what he said. I'm not going to preach. We got a preacher in the house on tonight. But you speak to where you want to be. You speak to where God has destined you to be. That's what he said. Before we have Sister Jasmine Cribs to come and bless us with the music ministry, I do want to introduce our speaker on tonight, Minister Amir J. Amen. And we have a biography here that was sent to me. Amen. And I'm going to read just a couple sentences from the biography. Amen. Because I'm excited to hear the ministry gift of our preacher on tonight. And y'all pray for me because this is little. And I know I got glasses on, but it's still little. Amen. All right. We're not getting old. I don't care what the National Baptist Convention say. We are youth and young adults past 35. Past 35, Pastor Johnson. That's it. Amen. And it reads, here we go. Minister Amir J is a native of Michigan. He accepted Christ around the tender age of 11 years old. He graduated from Southlake High School in 2020 with a 3.0 GPA. Amir accepted his calling to preach after a great, powerful service on New Year's Day in 2012. He preached his first message on January 12, 2012 at First Union Missionary Baptist Church under the leadership of Pastor Frank Knowlton Jr. He is currently the youth minister at his home church, Leland Missionary Baptist Church, and he also serves on the broadcast media team. Minister Ray is a licensed minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He has ministered at conferences, revivals, and churches in and out of the state of Michigan. He also has a broadcast every Friday night that is known as Friday Night Live on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok Live, and YouTube. Over the years of working in the ministry, he worked for a few well-known churches in the great city of Detroit to help build their youth ministry. One of listed here is the president of our Congress for the National Baptist Convention, Pastor Damon Mosley. It reads here that Minister Ray is a man who loves God, God's people, and his word. He enjoys family time, relaxing, reading, and learning whatever he can to share with others. Amen. Let's pray as the young Sister Jasmine Cribs come and minister before our preacher gets up before and render the word of God. But let's pray for him. Amen. As he stands before us, stands before God's people to deliver the word. Amen. Sister Cribs, if you can come at this time.
Good evening, church. So I've brought on this song tonight because it was in my spirit, so I'm going to sing it. Sometimes
Depression is all around, but God, His presence helps. Well, the enemy created wars, but remember giants, and they will fall. Speak over yourself, encourage yourself in the Lord. When there's weakness in me, oh, see, I'm encouraged, but no.
Would you please give God praise all over this place? Oh, come on, come on. If you know you're not here by accident, not by coincidence, sound man, wherever you are, give me a little bit of this monitor. Let's turn it up. If you know I'm here because I had to encourage myself. There are times I wanted to give up, but I encouraged myself. There are times I wanted to throw in the towel, but Pastor White, I encouraged myself. There are times I wanted to throw up my hands, but I encouraged myself. Would you take 1 minute and give God praise from the rising of the sun? One more time, lift this mic up. We about to have church in here. To the going down of the same, Jesus is worthy. He's worthy of my praise. He's worthy of my worship. He's worthy of all the honor. And so for that, I don't sit and I don't spectate, but I participate. And I say, God, move by your power. Move by your spirit. Do I have any young people that's going to turn up right here and say, I'm ready for God to show himself to me. I'm ready for the Holy Spirit to fall in this place. God, fall fresh in this place. Send your Holy Ghost. Like the old saints will say, I won't let you go until you bless my soul. One more time, lift up your voice. Let me hear a church. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Oh, come on, come on, come on, come on. Lift up your voice. Come on, come on. My God, Father will say, I'll stay there till I feel better. Come on, lift up your voice. Be seated in the Lord's church, for I get joy when I think about what is done for me. Dr. Hudson, I said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I just couldn't keep it to myself. Here is my shout. I don't know about y'all, for when I think of the goodness of Jesus, there are times I should have been dead, sleeping in my grave, but he made all death behave. When I think, Pastor Mosley, when I think of the goodness of Jesus, I don't need no help. I can just praise God all by myself. I can worship all by myself. I can give God praise all by myself. See, a lot of people think you're crazy, but it's just simply because he kept me.
When I didn't know how to keep myself, he kept me.
Oh. Oh. What a fellowship, what a fellowship. What a joy divine. Certainly, let me give God praise. Let me get back in order. Certainly, we give God praise for our present pastor, Jeremy Mosley. Would you all give God praise for him? Come on, come on. This is your president. This is your president. We thank God for the partnership of your moderator, none other than Pastor Ryan Patrick Johnson. I love this guy. I really do love this guy. And certainly we honor, I am big on honoring the first ladies, because there is no class, no catechism, no seminary on how to be a first lady. And so we honor the first ladies that stands beside them. Would you please give God praise for Lady Brittany and Lady Crystal Johnson? Oh, come on. Come on. I give God praise to Sister Denise Riley. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the fight, and I truly thank God for you. I give God praise for my pastor. He just left out. He had to make a run, and thank him for this permission or allowing me to be here today, Pastor Frank Knowlton, the Leland Missionary Baptist Church. Come on, give God praise for my pastor and his wife, Lady LaDon, which I know she's watching online. I love you so much. I love you. Thank you for tuning in. I give God praise. My mother is in the building today. Mama, would you just wave your hand? This is my biological. This is my mama, y'all. This is my mama. 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 Now, I had to do that, and I'm going to get into the sermon, but I had to do that because there was one time I went somewhere, and I forgot to acknowledge my mama. And the whole 2 months, my mama put me in the son dog house, didn't want to talk to me, didn't want to answer my phone calls, so I had to honor my mama. And to all of you God's children, we give God praise for you. My godfather, he just went to the bathroom, Pastor Jesse D. White, he is the third moderator. Would you all give God praise for him? And all of you God's children. To every pastor in the building, would you at least wave your hand? Wave your hand. I am honored that you all are here today. You could be somewhere else, but yet you're here praising God with your youth and young adults, so I thank you. And to every young preacher, would you all please stand real quick? Every young preacher, please stand. Every young preacher, every young preacher. These young men, and including myself, now I'm not gonna get into that. I ain't gonna get into that. These young men are the next generation fellowship. These are the young men who are, we're going to pass the mantle down to them. And so we know that there is a lot of time and a lot of maturity that needs to happen before that time be. But we just wanna let you know that you can trust us when that mantle has been passed down. It is people like Pastor Ryan Johnson and Pastor Jeremy Mosley who allow the opportunity of young preachers to stand and to show their yes. So we give God praise for every young preacher and these two preachers and pastors. Come on. All right, I won't prolong the time. I think I've said a lot, made a lot of announcements. I know Pastor and President Damon Mosley's watching online, so we give God praise for him also. And we thank God for him. But there is a word in Hebrews chapter 11. And it is a custom, if you please stand for the reverence of God's word. Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to start reading at verse number 1. And your Bible shall read, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtain a good report. Verse 3 says, through faith we understand that the world was framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Pastor Jeremy Mosley got good to me, and I was reading it at home, so I'm going to go ahead and read it a little further. It says, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness, and that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts. And by it, he's being dead yet spoken. It really got good to me when I read this part. It says, by faith, Enoch was translated, and that he should have not see death. And he was found because of God had translated him. For before his translation, he had a testimony that he pleased God. This is the favorite part. This is my favorite part, and I'll be done. Verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder to them that diligently seek him. I want to stop right there. I want to use for the time. I want to be great stewardship. I want to behave because Pastor Ryan Johnson going to whoop me in the back if I don't. I want to use for a subject of our theme, faith for the future. Would you look at somebody beside you and tell them, I got faith? Oh, come on. I got to hear you. Tell somebody, I got faith for the future. Lord, send your Holy Ghost. We need it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you lean over to your neighbor? This is the most I'm gonna have you lean over to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm glad to see you here. I'm glad to see you talking. Since you're talking, I know you're gonna help this young preacher preach. I have your word. Please don't lie in church. Thank you.
I hate to. Can you do this one more time? We just want to do this so y'all won't be mad. Can you open that up? 1909. How you open this? I know it's a Chevy Trailblazer. If you don't move your car, you're going to be told. All right? That's terrible. We had to mess up the sermon like that.
It was my mama, Lord Jesus. Y'all pray for my mama. Y'all pray for my mama. Y'all pray for my mom. Y'all, that one on me. That one is on me. That was on me. Oh, I wouldn't come to church if I couldn't laugh sometimes. Beloved brothers and sisters, it is a fact that while living in this world, there are a lot of things that you're going to need to be able to make it in this here life. My godfather said it like this. There are some things that are just not a foregone conclusion. You know you're going to need. We do know you're going to need gas to drive your car. It is a fact that you're going to need water to be able to survive. It is a fact that you're going to need clothes to be able to look presentable. It is a fact that you're going to need knowledge to be able to comprehend and understand things in this here world. It is a fact that you're going to need money to buy whatever it is needed for you to buy. It is also a fact that while living in this mean, crude, nasty, hungry, happy, sad, money-hungry, bipolar, mad, glad, dangerous world, that you're going to need Jesus on your journey. That's what it means if I want to pitch my tent for about 1 minute. When my great-great auntie will sing at First Union Missionary Baptist Church, I need Jesus on my journey to walk with in this narrow way. In other words, church, you do need Jesus on your journey, but in the event that you have Jesus on your journey, pastors, it is also a fact that you need faith in Jesus. You don't believe me. You don't believe me. For when you join the body of Christ, what they do is that they lay the chairs down at the altar. You come to the altar. They ask you a question. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? You say yes, because you believe and you got faith in Christ. They ask you, do you believe that he died for your sins and mine? You say yes, because you believe, and that is faith, that he
died for your sins and mine. And they ask you, do you believe that he got up on third day morning? You say yes, because you have faith and you believe that he got up on third day morning. So, beloved brothers and sisters, it is a fact that while living in this world, you need faith. For it was faith that Joshua was able to lead the Israelites to Canaan. I mean, it was faith that Noah was able to prepare an ark to be able to survive it for 40 days and 40 nights. I mean, it was faith that the three Hebrew boys was delivered from the furnace. I mean, it was faith that manna was sent from heaven. I mean, it was faith that Daniel was rescued from a lion's den. I mean, it was faith that Jonah was rescued from a belly of a whale. Should I press further? I think I'm going to do it anyhow. I mean, it was faith that David was able to slay a giant called Goliath. I mean, it was faith that Samson was slaying lions. But in the event that you have faith, beloved brothers and sisters, if you don't read your Bible, might not come down your row and help you. If you turn on a television, it is faith that Oprah got fired from her job, and now Oprah is worth $2.5 billion. I mean, it was faith that your grandmama, your grandmother favorite comedian by the name of Steve Harvey was homeless. He couldn't get right, but by faith, now Steve Harvey is now worth $160 million. I mean, it was faith that our first black president, a poor kid from Honolulu, Hawaii, by the name of Barack Obama, was a poor kid, but now Barack Obama is now worth $70 million. It is faith that you are here today, beloved brothers and sisters. If you don't turn on your television, why don't you ask your pastors or your leaders? I mean, it is faith that Pastor Ryan Johnson is here today after having to go through a sickness called COVID-19. I mean, it was faith that my pastor was here happened to have a minor stroke and have to go through COVID-19. I mean, it is faith that your leaders are here today. And some of y'all don't even have to go no further than yourself. You can testify that I'm here by faith. Some young person can be able to testify, I'm here by faith because I should be in the bathtub slitting my wrists, but yet I'm in the church house listing my wrists, giving God praise. Some of y'all don't even have to go no further than yourself. You can testify that I should be in mental institution, but the only institution that you in tonight is called the church. Some of y'all don't need to go no further. You can be able to testify that I should be on an obituary, but it is faith that my name is not on an obituary, but my name is on a program, and I'm here yet lifting up my hands, doing my Holy Ghost dance, not because I look so good, not because I dress so good, but I'm here, Pastor Sherrod, because of faith. And then I'll tell you something, and it was faith that got me here, and it's going to be faith that is going to lead me on. Can I tell somebody, one of my biggest flex ain't because I dress so good, Dr. C. It ain't because I look so well. It ain't because I'm tall, dark, and handsome. But my biggest flex is I got faith. Because when I wanted to give up, I had faith. When I wanted to throw in the towel, I got faith. When I wanted to throw up my hands, I got faith. Would you tell somebody, my biggest flex ain't that I drive a nice car. My biggest flex ain't that I live in a nice house. No, tell somebody, my biggest flex ain't that I have a whole lot of money. But my biggest flex is I got faith.
Pastor White, faith is a tough piece of cookie to work with. Faith, Dr. Suggs, it exposes the real Christians. Faith lets you know how real of a Christian you are. y'all still missing it, so let me help you. Faith is the intellectual understanding of God actually being himself, which is the essential key that unlocks the power of God. Oh, somebody say, preach, young man. I'm going to do it again because I'm repeating myself. I said, faith is the intellectual understanding of God actually being himself, which is the essential key that unlocks the power of God. And if you don't get that, let me help you out. If you want to see the power of God, you first have to see God for himself. And if you want to see God for himself, you got to have faith. I know you're dealing with a sickness, but I want to see God for himself to show me that he's a healer in a sick room. I know you believe that God would deliver you from your problems, but you first have to see him for yourself to let the people know he delivered me. Tell somebody, I need faith. I need faith. I am point one. What they didn't tell you is that I was quick. Point one, if you give me 10 minutes, I promise I'll be out of your way. Point one, I remember growing up in church called First Union. Every Friday we have something called youth meeting. And our youth director, her name was T-Dev at the time. What she did was she sat a chair in front of the church. What happened is that she told us to sit in the chair. And she said, how did we have so much faith in the chair, Pastor Josh? I see you, man. He said, how did we have so much faith in the chair? I want to argue with that a little bit, Pastor Johnson. It ain't that we had so much faith in that particular chair. It's that we had faith in all the chairs that we sat in previous times. Y'all still missing it. My point one is that you got to understand who to have your faith in. You got to have your faith in Jesus Christ and God. And let me tell you something. It ain't that you got your faith in him because of what he's doing right now. You got faith in him because what he done in the past, not what he done for you right now. Because he has a past portfolio that outbeats what facts is. Y'all making me go to point two before I even go. So stop that. But you ought to have faith in him. And you ought to understand that I got faith in him not because of what he's doing right now. It's simply because he has a past portfolio. What is his past portfolio? I'm glad you asked because I'm just itching to tell you the answer. His past portfolio is that he made the son that never needed to be relit or needed to go to the repair shop. What is his past portfolio? His past portfolio is that he put the whiteness in the snow, the wetness in the water, the greenness in the grass, the roof in the dog, and the meow in the cow. What is his past portfolio? I'm glad you asked because I'm itching to tell you the answer. He made a man out of dirt. And after he made a man out of dirt, he made a woman out of a man's rib. And after he made a woman out of a man's rib, they both put on Luther Vandross and Marvin Gaye, and they made all men. What is his past portfolio? His past portfolio is Pastor White from Malachi to Matthew. He was so mad at the world to where he doesn't say a word for 400 years, but he sent his son Jesus to hung, bled, and died for your sins. Uh-oh, y'all making me close already. For your sins and mine. His past portfolio, I'm not trusting him because of what he's doing right now. I'm trusting him because of what he done in the past. His past portfolio is that he brought me out of darkness into the marvelous light. Tell somebody, I'm trusting him because his portfolio speak for itself. Oh. I thought y'all Burnette was going to help me preach. I thought y'all was going to help me preach. Help me preach. You got to know who to trust in, Pastor, right? Not only you got to have faith, but you also got to understand that in life, faith always have to go into a wrestling match or a ring with facts. But here's the good news. Here's the good news. When faith goes into the wrestling match with facts, faith always come out on top. Y'all said y'all was going to help me preaching. Ain't none of y'all talking back to me. It was a fact that Moses couldn't lead the people across the Red Sea. Those are facts.
But faith steps in and say, walk on, little children. It was a fact that Lazarus could not raise himself from the dead. But faith steps in and says, just give Jesus Christ 4 days and he gonna say, roll the stone away. It was facts that 33-year-old man doesn't raise themselves up from the dead. But Jesus says, listen, count the three. I'm going to preach. And I'm going to do a revival in hell. I'm going to snatch the keys from hell. And I'm going to bring the captains back. And early one Sunday morning, I feel good in here. I'm going to get up with all power. Tell somebody, faith always overrides facts.
My godfather's here. He's going to whoop me if I don't do this. So the word faith in the Greek translate pistis. P-I-S-T-I-S. It's literally another word, a synonym for trust. Y'all missing it. Throughout the New Testament, church, there are a whole lot of scriptures that we ought to lean on to that got something to do with trust. Okay, y'all. Y'all gonna make me work anyhow, so I might as well do it. John 14:1 says, if you believe in God, that word believe also means trust. It says, believe also in me. Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledge Jesus and he will direct your path. I know I said New Testament, but let's go to the Old Testament. Psalm 20:7 says, some trust in the horses, some trust in chariots, but we will trust in the name of our Lord. Do I have any Bible readers? For the name of our Lord is a, and the righteous run in and they are saved. Matthew 17:20 says, for truly I tell you, Pastor Suggs, that if you have faith, trust in God, the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to a mountain and it shall be removed. I only mentioned your name because you said something about mountains. So this was my point. So let's go into it. Beloved brothers and sisters, I don't know what your mountain is, but you better have the trust in God that he will deliver you from the mountain. Can I ask y'all a question? What is your mountain? If it's suicidal thoughts, you got to learn how to stop running the suicide. You got to stop learning how to run to God about your suicidal thoughts and go run to your suicidal thoughts about your God. And what is your mountain? Is it anxiety? You got to learn how to stop running to God about anxiety and go run into anxiety about your God. What is your mountain? Is it school shootings? Well, you better stop running to God about school shootings and go run to school shootings and tell your school shootings about your God. What is your mountain? Well, you better stop running broke days to God and learn how to go run your broke. You better stop learning how to run God to broke days and go learn how to run broke days to your God. Tell somebody, I got faith that God will remove my mountains. Because, Pastor Don, it's nice to see you. Good to be in your presence, sir. Because for every mountain, he brought me over. And for every valley, he's seen me through. And for this, y'all don't know when to shout or praise God. And for this, I will. Do I have some radical praisers in here? Give you praise. This is one of my favorite points. For if I not recall, it was James who said it this way. Preachers, listen, if I'm saying the same thing the preacher said, let me tell you something, Pastor Ron Johnson, I would just throw this in. They broke in my house last night and looked at my sermon. That's the reason why I'm saying the same thing they said. But for it was James who said it this way. Faith without works
I got some Bible readers. Y'all came to preach. Y'all came to preach with me. But here's what I like about faith. When you have faith in Christ, it always produces good work. Some of y'all have faith, but you don't got the work. Some of y'all think that you can walk in a car lot, in the car dealership, and put your hands on the car and say, in the name of Jesus, it shall be mine. Not if you got seven repos, it shouldn't. But you got to understand that I got to put the work in order for me to get what God has for me. Some of y'all think you can go into a house, lay your hands on the house, and say, in the name of Jesus Christ, it shall be mine. So, not if you got two evictions, it won't. You ought to put the work in and tell somebody, I had to put my work in. I have faith in God, but I put my work in, and I trusted the Lord since. Oh, I'm sorry. Some of y'all saying, where was the work at in the Bible? I'm glad you asked, because I'm from Bethel Temple. I work at the Bethel Temple Church, and they taught me not to make it up, but look it up. If you're not remember, blind Bartimaeus was one who lost one of his senses, Pastor Johnson, but he made up in his mind, listen, I'm not going to let one of my senses stifle all my senses. So what I know is I'm going to hear that Jesus Christ is passing through the town. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to holler until he touched me. And let me tell you something. The faith was him believing that Jesus Christ could heal him. But the work was to holler. Y'all ain't helping me preaching here. For it was the woman with the issue of blood that crawled on her knees, and she made up in her mind, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. Let me tell you something. The faith was her believing that God could heal her, but the work was the crawling. I mean, it was a woman who was crippled for 18 long years, bent over, but every Sunday she kept coming to church. She kept coming to church. I mean, it was the faith of her believing that God will bring me through, but it was the work of her bent over and coming to church. And let me tell somebody, if they did the work, what you ought to do is you ought to do the work, because you ought to know that faith without works is dead. I'm a Baptist boy, so let me throw this in for free. It was Jesus Christ that had to go through death, hell, and the grave, but Sunday morning he gets up with all power. And he did the work, happened to go through death, hell, and the grave. But early Sunday morning, he gets up with all power. Church, all I'm trying to tell you is just do the work. Tell somebody, it may be hard, but do the work. It may be tough, but do the work. It may be rough, but do the work. It may be trying sometimes, but do the work. What you ought to do is tell somebody, do the work, do the work. Y'all sitting. Those of y'all sitting down at me, you can be seated. Those of y'all standing up with me, let's ride. Now let's have some church. Beloved brothers and sisters, what I want you to remember, if you don't see me no more, is that you better remember, is to do the work. I know you're having trials and tribulations, but you better remember to do the work. I know you're having times in your life to where you can't be able to see your way through, but you better remember is to do the work. Point number three is that you better remember, do it all, to still have faith in God. Well, I gotta close with a story that my godfather told me. He said there was a story of a young lady who came to church one Sunday, and she said, Lord, bless me with a new car. And she went down the steps. She walked out the door and she caught the bus home. The next Sunday came around. She said, Lord, bless me with a new car. Third gear, let's ride now. I need somebody to understand that the lady has said, Lord, bless me with the good God. Service was over. She went down the steps. She caught the bus home. Fourth Sunday came around. The youth and the young adults had told the pastor, you need to sit that woman down. She'd been saying, Lord, bless me with a good car. And we ain't seen it yet. You need to tell her to sit down. Then she got up fourth Sunday and she said, Lord, bless me with a good car. And then service was over. By the time the service was over, she walked down the steps and she realized that she missed the bus. She sat back on the porch of the church and she waited on the bus to roll back around. The pastor came out and asked the lady, is everything all right? She said, yes, sir, pastor. I missed the bus and I'm waiting on it to come back around. The pastor then said, well, that reminds me. I've been hearing you say, thank God for your new car. Is it because you don't want to drive it? She said, no, sir, that's not it. What can she say? Is it because family members are driving your car? She said, no, sir, that's not it. He said, I know. Is it because you done messed around and bought a limo and it broke down on you? She said, no, sir, that's not it. The pastor said, well, why are you thanking God for something that you have not got yet? The lady told the pastor, pastor, you should know you a pastor. But she said, just in case you don't know, I'm going to tell you anyhow. It ain't because somebody's driving my car. It ain't because somebody bought me a lemon. It's simply because I ain't got it yet. But I truly believe that since I ain't got it yet, he said, ask and it shall be given to you. Press down, shaking together, run it over. She went to the bus and she started singing, you can't hurry, God. You just have to wait. He'll be there. Don't you worry. He'll be there. She said, let me tell you something, pastor. When I needed a job, I didn't thank him till I punched in the job. She said, when I needed a husband, I didn't thank him until he walked down the aisle. She said, the doctor told us that we could not have any children. I didn't thank God until I rocked him in my arms. She said, now I know since he's gonna bless me with a good car, I'm not gonna wait till the battle is over. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna praise him right now. Well, I got Bible to back it up for you. You wanna help trust in God? The Bible says in Psalms 40 and 4, blessed be the man who put their trust in him. Psalms 37 and 3 says, trust in the Lord and he give you and do good and dwell in the land. Proverbs says, fear of man who will prove to be snare, but who
I'm gonna go. shall do it, because what father outside of Jerusalem, he died for your sins. And I know that Sunday morning, he died up with all power. And since he got up, now I can sit up and worship to the table.
I will trust in the Lord.
receive a soul, I will trust in the Lord. But my question to you, young people, is can God trust you? Y'all praise God, y'all speak in tongues, but so y'all praise God over here at the church, but you could. It's because faith for the future, not being faith in the future. So, Pastor Josh said, faith for the future, not being faith now. So my job is to extend invitation. Most of y'all are saved, but most of y'all are able to be saved. Talk with yourself to the young in the season space. Because I refuse, listen y'all, I refuse to have, I refuse to come to church every Sunday and still go to hell. If I go to hell, I need more oil. If I don't go to hell, I ain't going to church. So listen, anybody that's going to say, this is your day to change your life. This is your day. Your chance to get your prayer through. This is it. This is the time. I ain't gonna sing a song, but we're gonna sing. I don't know what the piece said. Lift your hands. You know what though? We try everybody else except Jesus. You try your boyfriend, he dumped you. Try your girlfriend, she dumped you. I can't go to church, Pastor C, because my job ain't work on Sundays. But get what though? The job lay you off. Got a new car. The car breaks down. But Jesus never leave you. Go and take you. I say, let's try Jesus. Try Jesus for yourself. Lift up your hands. The Bible said, death and life are the power of your tongue. Whatever you need God to do in your life, God is speaking. And sail to the path. Lift your hands. Open your mouths. I'm going to pray. We got to pray first. Death and life and power of your tongue. Hallelujah, Jesus. Why I try Jesus. See, young people, the reason why young people can't come to church because we as adults don't tell our story. How about this though? We gotta be transparent with your kids. Let them know that others always pass by that time. I have an issue. How about this? I still have an issue. Right now. Listen, y'all look at somebody. I am 38 years old. What are you doing? 34. Pastor C, if my father was capable right now, I don't know who he is. 38 years old, no father in my life. My soul, y'all. My soul. I talk to y'all, it's a miracle. Listen, the reason I tried Jesus, because this y'all, Holy Master, Holy Spirit said, fact says that I have a peace parent. The fact says that I will never talk. The fact says that I will never have a job. The fact says I will be living in your parents' crib. But faith is. Faith is. I can do more than you might. Faith is. Faith is. Faith says, by his life, faith is. I thought my own car. I live in the suburbs. I want to encourage some people today. If God can use me, God can use you. Listen up, people. Your past is your past. And your present is your past.
The gift to your future. So young people, be encouraged. Try Jesus because he tried you.
Church, say amen. Amen. Let's give God praise for Minister Ray. Amen. Let's give God praise for Minister Ray. I am thankful for him being with us. There, Pastor Mosley, I'm an airplane preacher. I have to back out and get on the runway and then take off. But there are other kind of preachers, I call them helicopter preachers. They just go straight up. This is a helicopter here, he don't, he goes straight up. He was sweating soon as he got started. I say he gone straight up now. But may God bless him and God keep him. And God bless all of you for being here. I was looking for my Congress president. He's here somewhere. But I want every young person here to just stand where you are. Just stand, every young person, every youth, every young adult. And I want, yeah, you too, you can stand. And I want you to come this way very quickly. And I want every seasoned person to point your hand to this altar. Come this way. Come this way. This is a different day. Our young people are plagued with things now that we weren't plagued with when we were growing up. And sometimes we don't think about that. They need our prayers. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we pray for our youth, our young adults. We pray our children today, God. They live in a world where they can go to school and not make it back home. They live in a world where it's dangerous to walk the street, dangerous to catch the bus. Danger is imminent and all around them. And Satan is attacking them. But Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray now that you will cover them under your blood. We pray now, oh God, that you would dispatch angels over each and every one of them to guide and guard and keep them. We pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that there will be no identity crisis with these. That there will be no suicide with these. That there will be no drug addiction with these. That there will be no alcoholics amongst these. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, keep them from the pimp. Keep them from the prostitute, oh God. Oh God, keep them as they go here and there and to and fro. God, in the name of Jesus, let their roots grow deep in your word. Let their roots go deep in your word, God, that they can be trees planted by the rivers of water. In the name of Jesus, cover them now. Oh God, if it be any unsaved, save, God. If there be any struggles, deliver, oh God. If there be any sickness, heal, oh God. You've got all power. You've got the power to save, heal, and deliver. Do it for our children. Do it for our youth. Do it for our young adults. Open doors, oh God, that no man can shut. Make ways and means, oh God, that they'll know that there is a reality in serving a true and living God. Bless them now. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Clap your hands if you're in agreement. God bless you. God bless you. So glad to have so many here tonight. And so glad to have our Congress President, BM&E State Congress, Pastor Damon Mosley. God bless you. So glad to have Reverend Joshua Smith here. youth pastor, New Bethel Baptist Church, who will be preaching for our youth and young adults in our state convention in just a few weeks. I want everyone to get close to a $20 seed as you can tonight. Sister Peaches never takes anything. She's a giver. But we want to be a blessing to help her to do what she does. Amen. The third vice moderator left his 20. I have my 20. Pastor C has his 20. And if our finance team would make ready, we would prepare to give. Daniel. You can give on Givelify, Fellowship District, and just mark it for youth ministry. You can give on Givelify. Thank you, First Vice Moderator Flanagan, who's given electronically. You can give tonight. God bless you. Please don't benedict yourself. We're almost through. We have a scholarship to give out. I want to explain something to all of you, and I wanted the pastor here when I explained it. You don't have to come all the way up, but I want to explain something. Pastor Mosley taught me a very valuable lesson. We don't force the Holy Spirit to do anything. Y'all saw me get up and go over there and cut it. Y'all saw that, didn't you? And some of y'all gonna talk about that later, so let me straighten it out now. Ain't no use in shouting music if ain't nobody shouting. And we've amplified this praise break thing to now. You don't need no Holy Spirit just long as you got some music. Y'all don't want to hear me now. I have to be the moderator now. And this ain't about the preacher. This is about us. If it's not, some things were not created to be forced. Pastor C. I never will forget. I was sitting right here where this preacher is sitting now, and Pastor was standing at the podium, and somebody tried to force something. He said, "You missed it," and he cut it right on off. So we don't force anything. We let the Holy Spirit have free reign and free course. We let him have his way. But that don't have nothing to do with the preacher. That have to do with us. Right? He did his shouting. I mean, he did it too. Changed keys and everything. He did his shouting. Amen. But we that are in worship, if we're not engaged in it, it don't mean anything. We're here to participate, not to spectate. Is that right? So I want to straighten that out before you go out and tell a story. Because you know I've been Baptist all my life. I know we'll lie, Deacon Smith. We'll go out and tell a lie faster than we tell the truth. And in accordance with the rules of the house, I don't force nothing. Is that right? So I wanted that cleared up, okay? Give the preacher a hand tonight. Thank you, Pastor. That's all. I didn't mean to disturb you, but I wanted to straighten that out. Now, I'm asked that you stand with that $20 gift as close to it as you can possibly get. Would you stand? Sister Adams is going to make her way this way, because soon as we finish giving, we're going to give out our youth scholarship, and I'm going to ask y'all, please don't leave till we give out this scholarship and give the benediction. Okay, come on around. Give us something, if you don't mind. Give us something, a little upbeat over there, and let's come around. Good to see you, Dean Finkley. God bless you. Come on around. Freddie in a singing mood today. Go ahead, Freddie. Yeah. All right, Sister Chambers. All right, Brother Newman. Father, thank you for the gifts and the givers, for the advancement of the kingdom and the support of this ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, Sister Adams. Would you come? We gave out 3 scholarships from our woman's auxiliary on yesterday. We're giving out. Yeah, give that a hand. We're giving out 1 scholarship from our youth and young adult ministry tonight. Give that a hand.
Thank you, moderator. All right, so I'm back in front of you again tonight because it is an honor to present scholarships to our youth and young adult. Particularly, I like doing scholarships for young people. But Sister Viola Riley had a vision to institute for the first time the Youth and Young Adult Scholarship. Very first time. But only one will be awarded tonight. But with prayers and hope, and you heard the pastor talk about faith, you got to speak it. Hopefully it'll go from one to many in the future. Subsequently, Sister Riley approached myself, and this is Sister Sabrina Howard, and she said to us, the 2 of you will be my scholarship committee. But moderator, it was done in, like a bully kind of manner.
Okay, I understand what you're saying.
Yes.
She made it.
She, yes, absolutely, in a bully kind of manner. So we did it. We didn't have a choice. We did it. So I'd like to ask, where is Sister Jasmine? She's here somewhere. Come on up. This awardee is no stranger to fellowship. As you heard, she was awarded on last night, and you also witnessed her in song on tonight. So I'm going to let her once again introduce herself, her church, her pastor, and anything else that she wishes to say.
Good evening, church. I'm back. Good morning. I mean, good evening. Sorry. It's been a long day. if you weren't here yesterday, I introduced myself. My name is Jasmine Cribbs, but everybody calls me Jazz. I attend the church that burns with heavenly fire. 16801 Schoolcraft. I almost said Detroit Youth Choir. Praise him. I attend the Greater Burnette Baptist Church on Schoolcraft. And my pastor is Pastor Ryan Patrick Johnson. My first lady's lady, Crystal Johnson. I'll be attending the number one HBCU. I'll be attending Tennessee State University in the fall. And I'll be studying mass communications and theater arts. And I would just like to say I'm very honored to not only get the scholarship from the women's night, but also the youth and young adult night. Because if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I would not be where I am today. Special shout out to my mama. I love you, mama. No, she's not here. She's watching. I love you, mama, so much. Ew, I couldn't have done it without her. And my dad in the back. Hi, dad. So, again, thank you so, so much. I very much appreciate it.
Okay. Don't go anywhere. We congratulate Jasmine. She strives for excellence. As you mentioned, she is a part of the Detroit Youth Choir. We had an opportunity before tonight to witness her in song at her interview. But one of the things I want to add is, I said to Sister Jasmine during the interview, so you applied for both the fellowship scholarship and the youth and young adult scholarship. I said, what was the motivation? What was your drive? And she said to me, well, I'm going to tell you like this. She said, my mother always told me that closed mouths don't get fed. Wise words. So I present to you, Jasmine, your scholarship award. Spend it wisely. And I want you to always continue to strive and remember some of the things that you told us during the interview. Opportunities are vast. Go get it. Congratulations.
God bless you. Wait a minute, I wasn't done yet. Oh, you've got something for, okay.
I just wanted to, I'm always buying something, y'all know that, y'all can't stop me. So what I wanted to give you two ladies, some monogram bags that I had made especially for you, and the stuff, I put stuff in there that I like. So, this is from me, from bossing y'all around, and I know y'all would like it. So that's all I wanted to say, so that's a gift from me.
Thank you. Thank you, ladies, so much. God bless you. One second. What I want to do tomorrow night in my address, I want to make a recommendation since the youth and young adult ministry, and it won't be in the printed address at this point now, but as I was standing here thinking, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me, that scholarship, our women's scholars give a scholarship. They gave out three scholarships, and that's the Dr. Dorothy J. Smith Scholarship. named after our longest serving woman's auxiliary president, who meant so much to this body, Dr. Dorothy J. Smith. And many of you remember her. She labored here for many years in this work. But my recommendation tomorrow, and where's, oh Lord, I don't see him either. Okay. But my recommendation tomorrow that will not be printed, that as our youth and young adults build a scholarship platform, there was a lady that worked very hard amongst our young people. And I'm going to not say too much about it because I might get emotional about it, really. But many of you knew Sister Annie Pearl Flowers Jackson Loritz. And she worked very hard in this district with young people. And I believe we should bestow the scholarship in her honor to our young people. And that will be a part of my recommendation tomorrow. Now, are you? Okay, I didn't call for that. I'm going to do like Mother Frances Kelly in the Church of God. I didn't call for backaches. Now I'm just teasing. Yeah. Okay, well, anyone with a presentation, would you come? Where's the other folks? Where? Oh, okay. All right. Sister White has a special presentation, and I know it's special because she's been telling me about it all day, that she wants to make. So would you stand, Sister Peaches? Would you stand?
Well, all of Peaches Committee, please stand. All of y'all, please stand. Sister Peaches, on behalf of all of us, turn around, look at them. And then turn, look at all of us. We just wanted to let you know that we appreciate you. We love you. We thank you for choosing us to work with you. You didn't have to do it, but you did. And we thank you for that. And we just want to tell you how much we love you. So we're giving you this envelope full of love. It's full of love. Comes from all of us over here. It's full of love because we love you. And keep on doing God's work. And what I always tell you, don't get weary in well-doing, because you are doing well. So never get weary in doing God's work, baby. Love you.
Amen. Love you. God bless you. Thank you so much. Sister Peaches, you want to come make some remarks and we prepare for adjournment? We prepare to go.
Good evening. I won't be long. Y'all know that. First, I want to recognize our moderator, Pastor Ryan Johnson. I love you so much. I know. Our Congress, where is he? Okay. Our Congress President, Pastor Jeremy Mosley. Let's give him a hand. I want to recognize, I think, our layman's president, Deacon Donald Crawford is here. I think I saw him back there. Can we just, Dwayne? What did I say? Okay. Okay. Our president of our women's, Sister Linda Allen, I love you so much. Our state president, Congress president, I thought I saw him still here. Okay. Hi. Okay. Anyone else that's in the building from state and nationals, thank you for coming out tonight. My team, I love these guys so much. I'm telling y'all, they make this so, so easy for me. Just please get them another hand for me. I just want to say this. We had one meeting, and we was coming up with all these ideas and everything. Deacon Corey, stand up for a second. Okay.
Deacon Corby's idea. Actually, we throw it around. He said, why can't we can't have our own lecture? I was like, well, let me talk it over with our moderator and see what he say about it. And then I came back, I talked to him, he said we can do it. And I just want to thank you, Deacon Corby, for coming up with them ideas, and be ready for next year because you're going to be part of the lecture. It's your idea, okay? Amen, amen. One more other thing. We have Congress every year. And with the scholarship fund, I really would like to have to see more of our youth come out to help us, you know, during Congress week. That right there will help me more. If you say you love me, show me you love me, because I'm not, it's a show me thing. So if you love me, I think we only get together maybe 3 times a year. In March, the third week in March, I want to see some of the young people come out and help Diamond and her sister Debbie. Y'all be, oh, yeah, okay. We trying to create things for you guys to do, not us. We want you to come in and show what you can do so we can do that. So next year, I'm going to be looking for the one that said I'll be there. I'm going to look for all of y'all to come out and help us grow this Fellowship District Youth and Young Adults, all right? And I also want to thank that next generation is what the three young men. Set up, y'all. Well, thank y'all so much for accepting the call to come in and help us out. And there's so much more to do in this Fellowship District, Youth and Young Adults, and I will be calling on you guys. I'm going to call you. Trust me, I'm going to call. Minister Amir, we had a discussion, I think it was last year, and I said, hey, we got something coming up. I'm going to see if I could talk to my moderator so I can have you come over and, you know, minister to us. And you was like, I got you. So I just want to thank you so much for coming and blessing us. I love you so much. God bless you. I bless you. My brother, I just want to thank you for coming. You always tell me, I got you, I'm coming. Don't worry about it. Thank you so much for tonight. Don't y'all leave, because y'all know I'm going to be doing something. So don't y'all leave, okay? My first vice president, Lord have mercy, Jesus. Stand up for me, please. See, y'all have to please him. I love you, Dr. Clay, and he'll be behind me 100%. And thank you so much for everything, all the advice, all the late phone calls, me fussing, and I ain't gonna say that other word, but you listen to me, and you always help me. So. I'm getting there, y'all. Thank you so much. I love you dearly, okay? I hope I didn't miss nothing, but I love you guys. Thank you so much.
God bless you. Stand up, Pastor Johnson. Where did your wife, you and your wife, stand up? They were here. Now, let me tell you all, this is called dedication. They just celebrated, was it Monday? Monday, they celebrated their 19th wedding anniversary. But they celebrated it here at the district. Tomorrow is his birthday, Pastor Clarence Johnson's birthday, and he's going to be here at the district. So I thank you for sharing all these momentous occasions with Fellowship, all right? God bless you both. Don't forget, if you need something to eat, Hollywood is down there with fish, chicken, and all the fixings and trimmings that go with it. Cordell was probably feeding his face. That's why he wasn't here when they called it. But I'm just telling you, fish, chicken, whatever you, please go get a dinner on your way out, take it home, have it for lunch tomorrow, whatever the case may be. Thank God again for all of you being present. And if you have some black tomorrow, put it on, okay? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, if you have, if God gonna get some of us for that telling the truth, because everybody got one good black something. Amen. At least one. Every preacher ought to have one black suit. Huh? Every preacher ought to have one black suit. Caleb got on one today. It's got a little extra to it, but just put it on and let's come in here and whatever is left, because, you know, this preacher really, he really squalled and carried on. So whatever's left, I'm going to try to say something. Let us stand. Let us stand. Let us stand. Let us stand. Please don't forget tomorrow at 6 o'clock, or don't forget intercessory prayer at 5:45, but at 6 o'clock, Dr. Nathan Johnson. And you talking about a preacher. Dr. Nathan Johnson will be here tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. He's the president of Wolverine State Baptist Convention, pastor of Tabernacle Baptist Church, but he's a great preacher. And you want to be here to hear him. Our Father, we thank you now. We thank you for our time together. Thank you for all the words that have gone forth. Help us to be better. Help us to have faith for the future. Lord, we believe, and if there's any unbelief in the room, we pray as we leave that you would help our unbelief. Pray that you would keep us. Bring us back together tomorrow night for the conclusion of the whole matter. Bless us as we leave this place, but never from thy presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Tell your neighbor, I love you. You can't do a thing about it.